di Sarjana. Mulai dari pengenalan kegiatan kampus bagi mahasiswa baru atau PKKMB, mata kuliah pembentukan karakter yaitu Pancasila, pendidikan kewarganegaraan, bahasa Indonesia, pendidikan bela negara, outbound bela negara, dan kuliah kerja nyata bela negara. Serta kegiatan lain pendukung seperti unit kegiatan mahasiswa. Di antaranya, resimen mahasiswa, mahasiswa pecinta alam, pramuka, bela diri tradisional, seni tari tradisional, dan olahraga. Dalam perkembangannya, UPN Veteran Jawa Timur telah mengalami beberapa perubahan status dari perguruan tinggi negeri kedinasan menjadi perguruan tinggi swasta. Hingga akhirnya sejak 6 Oktober 2014, berdasarkan Perpres Nomor 122 Tahun 2014, UPN Veteran Jawa Timur secara resmi ditetapkan sebagai perguruan tinggi negeri. Dengan visi menjadi universitas unggul berkarakter bela negara, pada tahun 2016 UPN Veteran Jawa Timur mendapatkan akreditasi institusi perguruan tinggi A. Pada 2018 UPN Veteran Jawa Timur berhasil mendapatkan status pengelolaan keuangan Badan Layanan Umum, serta pada tahun 2019 UPN Veteran Jawa Timur berhasil menorehkan peringkat 40 sebagai perguruan tinggi terbaik di Indonesia oleh Kemenristekdikti. Veteran Jawa Timur senantiasa mencetak pionir pembangunan yang memiliki inovasi, mampu berprestasi untuk meraih sukses. UPN Veteran Jawa Timur memiliki 7 fakultas yang terdiri dari Fakultas Ekonomi dan Bisnis, Fakultas Pertanian, Fakultas Teknik, Fakultas Ilmu Sosial dan Ilmu Politik, Fakultas Hukum, Fakultas Arsitektur dan Desain, dan Fakultas Ilmu Komputer. Ada 7 bidang yang menjadi sasaran prioritas dalam penataan perangkat dan penguatan kelembagaan menuju profesionalisme yang berbasis riset serta daya saing global untuk pembangunan universitas, bidang pendidikan dan pengajaran, bidang penelitian dan pengembangan kepada masyarakat, bidang organisasi, bidang keuangan, bidang sumber daya manusia, bidang sarana dan prasarana, serta bidang kerjasama.
Semoga ke depan UPN Veteran Jawa Timur semakin meneguhkan sebagai perguruan tinggi negeri yang mempunyai daya saing tinggi di bidang tridharma perguruan tinggi, tidak saja di tingkat nasional, tapi juga di internasional.
Pak Fahri,
For all the attendants and also the panelists, may I have your attention, please? Our opening ceremony is about to begin. Please have a nice seat and make sure you mute your microphone during the event, except you are asked by the MC or moderator. Thank you so much. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Good morning from Indonesia. The Honorable mention to Dr. Insinyur Nora Agustin, KMP, as the Dean of Agriculture Faculty UPN Veteran East Java. The Honorable mention to specialist guest speaker today, Associate Professor Dr. Seka Gandaseka from University Putra Malaysia. The Honorable to Dr. Firman Farid Muhsoni, SPI, MSc, from Trunojoyo Madura University. The Honorable to Dr. Insinyur Sudiarto, MM, from UPN Veteran East Java. The Honorable to Haidar Fari Aditya, SP, MP, and the Honorable invite guests and all participants. First of all, let us pray and praise to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because of His bless and mercy, we can join up together without any obstacle here via Zoom meetings. Second, let us greet and pray to our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who had brought us to the path of light and left the darkness in this life. It's been a great honor for me, Inas Arifatunisa, to be your master of ceremony and welcoming all of you in the Visiting Scientist program of agriculture with the topic Optimalization of Mangrove Ecosystem Led to Sustainable Goals. Ladies and gentlemen, on this nice occasion, let me deliver the structure of the event today as follows. First, opening. Second, singing the national anthem Indonesia Raya and Bela Negara March. Third, welcoming speech from the Dean of Agriculture Faculty. Fourth, main session material. Fifth, second session material. Sixth, last session material. Ladies and gentlemen, the first, let us listen and singing the national anthem of Indonesia Raya and Bela Negara March. Thank you very much. Ladies and gentlemen, now we invite Dr. Insinyur Nur Agustin KMP as the Dean of Agriculture Faculty, UPN Veteran East Java, to give the welcoming speech. To the Dean of Agriculture Faculty, time is yours.
Terima kasih, Mbak Inas. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Good morning, be happy and health. Honorable my Rektor UPN Veteran Jawa Timur, Profesor Dr. Ahmad Fauzi MMT, and then yang terhormat pimpinan Fakultas Pertanian, Sewadek, Pak Trimujoko Wadek 1, Bu Dr. Mubarokah Wadek 2, Dr. Muhammad Arifin Wadek 3, Sekajur, Kajur Agroteknologi, Profesor Dr. Yuli Santoso, MP, Kajur Agribisnis, Dr. Sudiarto, MP, beliau nanti juga sebagai speaker. Kemudian Sekjur, Dr. Insinyur Sriwiyatiningsih, MP, Sekjur Agroteknologi, dan Sekjur Agribisnis, Dr. Insinyur Nuriyah Yuliati, Sekaprodi S1, Dr. Insinyur Bakti Wisnu, Dr. Insinyur Hamidah, Dr. Dari S2, Dr. Insinyur Penta, juga kemudian Insinyur Sri Widayanti, MP, kemudian S3 Agribisnis dirangkap oleh Bapak Dr. Insinyur Sudiarto, MP, Sekaleb, para dosen, lecturer, Fakultas Pertanian UPN Veteran Jawa Timur, and all participants, we meeting in a visiting scientist. And then, honorable, my guest speaker, Associate Professor Dr. C. Chagandarecha. It's true. Professor Dr. C. Chagandarecha from Faculty of Forestry and Environment, Universitas Putra Malaysia. Welcome to UPN Veteran Agriculture Faculty in Surabaya.
Thank you.
And then, okay, and then speaker to Dr. Firman F. Musoni, SPE, MSc, from Faculty of Agriculture Trunojoyo, Madura. Selamat datang Pak Firman di Surabaya.
Selamat datang, Bu.
Yeah. And then speaker three is my family, Dr. Insinyur Sudiarto, MM. Selamat datang, Pak. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Good morning. Welcome this virtual meeting in scientist visiting scientist. I hope always Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah give his love to us. Ladies and gentlemen, visiting scientists, this meeting in annual in Agriculture Faculty in UPN, Veteran Jawa Timur. And then we have a title, Optimization of Pangroof, Ecosystem Lead to Sustainable Goal. I hope this meeting is very developing cooperation between UPM, UTM, and Fakultas Pertanian UPN Veteran Jawa Timur. We have collaborating to education, research, and student and lecturer exchange to learning agriculture sustainable. We hope between us is very collaboration, the istilahnya tridharma perguruan tinggi. in Indonesia. And then I hope all participants, all team, task force, moderator, Dr. Pak Haidar Fari, this my lecturer, new lecturer in faculty. Yeah. Thank you. We collaboration with student and lecturer in agriculture UPN Veteran Jawa Timur. Finally, I would like to say happy discussion, success, and good health for everyone. Thanks for everyone. Good scientists, visiting scientists in agriculture UPN Veteran Jawa Timur. Selamat datang, sukses, be happy. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Thank you so much to Dr. Insinyur Nora Agustin KNP for your welcoming speech. Now we come into the main session, that is the Visiting Scientist Program of Agriculture, with the topic that we bring is Optimalization of Mangrove Ecosystem Lead to Sustainable Goals. This main event will be led by Mr. Haidar Fari Adia, SPMP from UPN Veteran East Java. To Mr. Haidar Fari Adili, SPMP, time is yours.
Thank you, Inas. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Assalamualaikum. Welcome to the virtual seminar of Visiting Scientist Program in Delta Optimization of Mangrove Ecosystem to Sustainable Goals. My name is Haidar Fari Aditya, lecturer at Faculty Agriculture, UPN, serta pelajar daripada UPM, maupun syarikat dalam bidang mangrove dekat Malaysia. Kami telah menerima kehadiran pelajar selama 19 pelajar daripada UPM. Terima kasih telah meluangkan masa dalam mengikuti visiting scientist di UPN Veteran in the past 30 years. Indonesia has lost over 40% of its total mangrove forest. This has happened due to mangrove conversion to agriculture and aquaculture. The conversion caused the emission of gases. Today, our first speaker will be presenting about how to manage the mangrove forest. Then, our speaker will be enlightening us about carbon estimation in mangrove forests. At the end, the concept of the mangrove forest, the participation of farmers, is urgently needed. And our third speaker will deliver the farmers' participation of mangrove rehabilitation. Before we started, let me greet the three wonderful speakers in this seminar. Our first, Dr. Secha, good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning. How are you, doctor?
I'm fine. Thank you, Fari.
I will stay healthy, doctor. For your information, Dr. Secha is my former advisor on my master joint degree program in UPM Malaysia. Such a reunion. It is my pleasure to have you here, doc. The second speaker is Dr. Firman Farid Musoni, SPE MSc, lecturer from Universitas Trunojoyo Madura. Good morning, doctor.
Ini ono seminar apa ini pertanian ini?
Good morning, Dr. Firman.
PMUPN.
Jurnalis Dr. Pak Firman.
Dr. Firman.
Jurnalis Pak Firman.
Dr. Firman. Okay, sir. Technical problem. Okay. And the third speaker is Dr. Insinyur Sudiarto MM, lecturer from our faculty, Agriculture Faculty, Universitas Pembangunan Nasional Veteran, Jawa Timur. Good morning, Dr. Dr. Sudiarto. Okay, I think the session we will have Dr. Firman and Dr. Sudiarto together and followed by Q&A session. All right, let's get into the first session of the seminar. I would like to read Dr. Secha's CV. Okay, please committee, the share screen, okay. He is an associate professor from Department of Natural Resource Industry Forest Ergonomy. Dr. Secha graduated from IBB University for bachelor degree in 1989. Then he achieved master degree in 1995 and PhD in 1998. Both of the degree come from Kyoto University, Japan. Dr. Secha is active researcher. We would like to invite Associate Professor Dr. Ganja Secha to present the lecture for 25 minutes. Dr. Secha, yes. Are you ready? Okay, time is yours, doctor.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, doctor, you can start.
Okay.
Doctor, I'm sorry. Your voice. I think
maybe. Okay. Voice. Okay. Can you hear me? Okay.
Yeah. Yes. Hello. Yes. I can hear you.
Thank you to the committee and of course to the Dean of Agriculture, Dr. Ibumora, a chance to present my presentation today. Okay, this is the title of today's Sustainable Forest Management and for Operation System of Mangrove Forest in Peninsular Malaysia. Next. So the outline of today's lecture is the first. Maybe I would like to first introduce a bit about EPM. Lecture is the first time. And then I would like to introduce then sustainable mangrove forest. And then mangrove forest the first time. Okay, welcome to UPM. So maybe not everyone here in institution, one school, graduate school, and one sport academic, with about 26,000 students. Yeah. Next. Okay. So the campus around 3,700 hectares. Yeah. We have two campus here. Campus UPM Serdang in Peninsular Malaysia and one campus in Bintulu. Yeah. Next. Okay. So this is 16 faculties. So we have two faculties at UPM Bintulu Sarawak campus. Faculty of Agriculture and Forestry Science and Faculty of Human Management Science. And then I belong to Faculty of Forestry and Environment. So we have a one school graduate studies and STEM institute and one sport academy. From this sport academy has been produce many athletes of Malaysian, yeah, including one student has achieving that gains or gold. What the second medal? Yeah, not gold medal. okay. So in what it calls is the Olympic, and in this our student. So this is in UPM between undergraduate and postgraduate, most maybe half and half. Yeah, maybe later on we would like to be 50 undergraduate and 50% postgraduate. This is our goals later on. Yeah. And then we have also international students is about around 4,000, yeah, from 25,000 students. Next. And then we have also next, okay. This is current UPM ranking, and the words is based on the word QS World University ranking. So we have achieved from since 2016 about 300 in the world. And now we have been achieved as 152, yeah, in the world, yeah. And then in Asia, we have rank as 25, the best university in Asia, and of course rank in UPM in Malaysia is the second one after Malaysia UM, yeah, University of Malaysia. And we also best young university, because UPM is still young university, is under 50 years. So mean that in the world we are the rank 10, yeah, in the world as the best young university. And then in green metric, because we have also using a sustainably environmental and so on and so forth. So we concerned about that one. And in the world we rank as a 28, yeah. As a university green metric world university rank. That's what our achievement of UPM. Okay, that's all maybe from UPM. Anyone who interested to continue your master or PhD in UPM, most welcome from UPM veteran is Java, and of course from University Teknologi Madura, yeah, Trunojoyo Madura. Welcome to UPM. Of course, as mentioned by the dean, we also is welcome to collaborate with all of you, yeah, with UPM veterans, is Java, and of course with UTM Madura. Welcome to make a collaboration the next year in terms of collaboration in terms of student exchange, lecture exchange, supervisory, and so on and so forth. Thank you. And then let's start. That's all for UPM. Hopefully that a bit, yeah, introducing about our university in Malaysia. Okay, today is so I would like to share about the sustainable forest management and forest operation system of mangrove forest in Peninsula Malaysia. Meaning that in Malaysia we have a part of mangrove forest that utilizing by the people for producing charcoal product. Yeah? Okay, next. Okay, next. Okay. What is mangrove? Mangrove is a woody plant that grow at the interface between land and sea in tropical and subtropical latitude, where they exist in condition of high salinity, extreme tides, strong winds, high temperatures, and muddy and aerobic soils. And of course, mangrove ecosystem is among the most productive ecosystem in the world, with well-established ecological, economical, and cultural importance. Next, okay. So again, we'd like to share about what is mangrove first, and that is a kind of mangroves. So we can see the structure of the roots. The roots is not only inside of the soil, but of course some of the root is come from up of the ground. Above ground, we have also the kind of root like this one. Yeah. It is a kind of mangrove forest. That's why this mangrove forest become important to protect our land from the sea. Yeah? Okay, next. So the important the mangroves, the first is, as I mentioned before, is coastal shoreline protection, because we have a structure of the mangrove that can protect our land, yeah, from the seaside. And then fisheries, some fisheries we can take from the mangrove, and wildlife also, and then ecotourism. and carbon soil, of course, because this one waterlogged, yeah. So meaning that this one is became efficiently store our carbon from air to the store in the soil, yeah, and then because very very efficient. And then timber plant, of course, and product and renewable resources and nursery, because this one is one we cut and then we can plant again. Okay, next. So this is a kind of situation in one of mangrove area. Yeah, that some area has been utilized by some villages or fishermen and so on and so forth. Yeah, so many things. And also for fisheries, aquacultures, tourism, and so on and so forth. And then next, okay. Okay, so this mangrove biodiversity, mangrove occupy the intertidal zones, interact strongly with aquatic, insults, upstream, and terrestrial ecosystem. In this way, mangrove helps to support diverse flora and fauna of marine, freshwater, and terrestrial species. Yeah, and then mangrove flora and fauna. Yeah, we have so many flora and fauna, and then what we call this one. One kind of very famous monkey, yeah? Okay, and then next, okay, this one is the mangrove tree species, yeah, mangrove tree species and structures. So we can see the structure of the trees from the seashore until the in the seaward, middleward, and then landward. Yeah, that's many kind of very important trees. Yeah, like rhizophora. Next, maybe click a bit. Okay, so please click. Okay, hello. Okay, thank. And then okay, next. Yeah. Oh, okay. So okay. Before that, maybe this. Before that, there's some kind of any kind of actually like the Jepora, Epicenia, and so on and so forth. Yeah, that's very important. And today's would like to introduce the mangrove forest in Peninsular Malaysia. So mangrove forest in Peninsular Malaysia are found mainly on the sheltered coasts, estuaries, rivers, and some near shores islands. Mangrove forest management system has undergone changes, primarily managing for its wood produce, to a management system that incorporates multiple roles, protection and conservation. And according to the UN FAO, in Malaysia, actually, yeah, Malaysia, the whole Malaysia covered by about 20 million, yeah, 20 million hectare is a forest, covered by the forest. And mangrove is only a bit, because only seashore, so only 107,000 hectares in Peninsular Malaysia. Okay, next, let's see, okay, next. This distribution of forests, mangroves, mangrove forests in Peninsular Malaysia. So the most or the large area is in Perak, yeah, following the Johor and then Selangor and Kedah and so on and so forth. So I have so many research in Perak, also in Johor and Selangor, also in Terengganu, yeah. We have so many research area. Okay, next. Okay. This is the okay. This is the floor of Matang. Okay, next. Okay, this the okay. The floor of Matang mangrove. So we have 7 families, 28 species, and then of course we associate mangrove is with 10 families, about 13 species as associate mangrove species. The true mangrove only 28 species that found in this area. Yeah? And then next. So this one about mammals. Yeah, we have also find some mammals in Matang mangroves. So we have 12 penguins, about 20 species, long-tailed macaques, like I have mentioned in the photograph just now, red, beige, corals, and of course, maybe some mammals and so on and so forth. And resident species, about 38 families, about migratory, yeah. Migratory swift crab and so on, so and 61 families like crabs, blakes, grouper, shrimps, prawn and so on, so forth. So we have birds, we have mammals, and we have marine life also. And next, next, So this one is, we have a fauna of Matang mangrove forest, so many fauna found in area of the mangrove. That one is become, some is for for ecotourism also, yeah, because some tourism come to see the real life and the some like dolphin and also eagles and so on and so forth, yeah. And we hope, because we have also one migratory birds, yeah. Next, we have one area in Matang mangrove forest that this one is flyways from migratory birds in Asia Pacific region. For example, some from Australia come to this area, and sometimes the other season come from China come to this area again. And this is flyways of migratory birds in Asia. This one is a kind of very attractive to some tourism come to this area. Okay, next. Okay. So let's start with the forest operation in mangrove. In this mangrove, we also some area we let to the people to harvest some trees for producing charcoal. So mangrove forest operation system. What kind of system in Matang mangrove forest? Let's see. Maybe next. Okay, next. Okay, forest harvesting is among the contributor to the socio-economic activities in Matang mangrove forest beside aquacultures. Maybe you can back again a bit. Okay, no, back. Okay. So the main product of, okay. So I think this one is area in mangrove, Matang mangrove forest. So, okay, so this area we have some certain like terong, palas petang, and so on and so forth. And then we let some people to do some of us harvesting inside this area, and maybe under control. So it has been gazetted as a forest operation since 1902. Yes, since the colonialization of the British, yeah. And then still continue until now, and continue, and then meaning that is sustained. We have a sustained this area because after cutting and then replanting again, planting again, so until now. And then the area is still sustained until now. Next. So this operation consists of three main operations. The first is felling, barking, and debarking. And the next is loading, manual skidding, and so on and so forth. And loading on board water transport, unloading and to the kiln drying in jetty. Yeah, this one the second of the activities of forest operation in the mangrove forest. Yeah, from standing tree, felling, barking, manual skidding, loading. Yeah, and then unloading and log on and then loading again and go to water transport by boat and unloading and to go to the kiln drying jetty. Okay, next. Okay, this is a photograph where I have get some photograph one using once that's operate. The operation is conducted at the area. So they will cut the trees. Yeah, the trees has been maybe waiting about 30 years. Yeah, 30 years to wait. Yeah, and they're not so big, but maybe about the biggest is maybe about 30 cm. And then they cut by chainsaw. And then next. So after felling, this almost all everything is manually, yeah, conducted manually. Okay, no machinery here, no heavy equipment, because this one is waterlogged area and this muddy area, yeah. And this is stack around timbers also to cut standard length. So how to debug is using the hammer, like using the not the true hammer, is using the wood hammer, so like this. So how difficult to debug, yeah, the this activity. And then next. Okay, next. Okay, not go. Okay, this one, this platform, and then this one is the people manually skidding using wheelbarrow, yeah. So see how hard this one, yeah, because we cannot utilize some machinery, so automatically only allowed by manual system. So here's as many Indonesians also come here to work as work. And then this after cutting, and then we divide into small logs about 1.6 meters tall, and then debarking, and then we try to skip or bring this kind of logs to the seashore or maybe to the log pond in the jetty or maybe log pond around the seashore. Okay. Okay, next. So we okay. This one is the once we are already go to the like the seaside, the for example not seaside, but this one is maybe a riverside. So all has been ready to load, yeah, to load to the boat. So this one we wait some maybe boat come return with empty empty load from the Kilindran come, and then we load this kind of loads to the boat, and then after that load water transport using boat from the harvesting area to the Kilindran or to the mill, yeah. Okay, next, this log water transport, and this one arrive at the kiln dry. So this is the kiln pond. So we unload of also this one is manually, yeah, manually using the people to bring all of the logs from the boats to the kiln, yeah, and then they prepare to go to the kiln, and then next. Let's see. Next is they will bring all of this one to the kiln. This kiln is one kiln served by 2 hectares. Yeah, we need 2 hectares. 2 hectares every year will can cover one kiln. Yeah. After all of this logs put inside, and then the kiln will close. Yeah, will close seal with some cement and so on and so forth. And then they starting by burn all of the logs inside about 6 to 8 days. Yeah, we wait 6 until 8 days. Okay, then next. Okay, this one is the time of productivity has been done. This one has been published at the Forest and Society, yeah, journal. So it's the Q2 rank in term of Scopus. This time study and productivity of mangrove forest operations utilized by 2 or 3 forestry workers in Mata Mangrove Forest. So this one, the time distribution, profiling, barking, debarking, manual skiing wheelbarrow, using wheelbarrow, water transportation, and so forth. And we can find the productivity also, yeah, time and productivity. And we can see the time. And then next is the cost analysis. Okay, the time is, okay. The cost analysis for failing barking and debarking, manual skiing, water transportation, and so on and so forth, and load volume and cost. They will pay per 9 ton. 9 ton then pay. 9 ton then pay. Yeah, okay. For example, wages for 9 ton for failing barking until manual skidding only 260 ringgit per 9 ton. Yeah, 9 ton. And then water transportation is 80 per 9 ton. Okay. So this one is the net profit. Still they can gain some money per day is about 235. This was for 9 ton. If they can double, so they can accept double. For example, if double means 18 ton, so they will gain about 470 ringgit per day. So not bad, yeah. Per day, yeah, it's about 1.5 million ringgit per day they can gain for 2 or 3. We need that people can receive about 500,000 rupiah per day if they collect with 3 people. If 2 people, the more, yeah. And next, and then the, so we can see the contribution from the forest, mangrove forest to the people. The, from the harvesting of mangrove to the poles and greenwood for the production of circles. The first is for tree fells. This has been waited for 30 years. So we can see We have about 40,000 hectares, but only 830 hectare only. We need only 2% only we can cut for annually. We need that. That's why we can keep the sustainability, because not so many hectares in one time. So only just 2% per year, yeah, from the whole area to harvest, yeah. So and in this one is can contribute annual production that's about 45,000 tons and can give a value about 27 million ringgit, yeah, 3 million ringgit, 27 million ringgit in years, yeah. So and then this one is come from fell, and then of course come also from thinning, because during from planting until before we cut at the 30 years old, about 12 years or 50 years old, we can do up some thinning to make some maybe space for the good poles. And then from this one we also can collect about 2.5 million, yeah, from the thinning. So we need it, the combination, the together of this one, we about 30 million. 30 million can contribute per year to the people. That one, the people can live and then can continue this business, yeah? Okay, this operation system. This is, and then next, okay, from 30 million that can collect, they need to pay to the state, yeah, to the Forest Department of Peninsular Malaysia, FDPM, yeah, about 1.3 million per year, yeah. This one is using for planting, yeah. This and then FDPM will plant the area about 2 hectare every per, for example, per per kilon, so about 330 year per years. The 800 of 30 years will replanting, yeah, replant it again, and then they will wait about 30 years for the next cycle. Okay, next. So that's why maybe we can keep, okay, this one is from the forest operation system. So next we would like to continue with the Mata Magra, okay. Okay, this one is for sustainability. So Mata Magra Forest is under systematic has been starting in 1904, yeah? So considered as the best managed mangrove forest in the world. And mangrove forest, and Mata Magra Forest as the most
sustainable 5 minutes again.
Around the world, especially in forest resources, an important role in supplying yield of forest. Since 1919 until now, yeah? Continue supply the material for Tamatamarka is about 40 hectare, and then we can see that the sustainability has been done, and then as previous next.
Teacher, 5 minutes again.
Okay, 5 minutes. Okay, yeah. Okay, let's see next for the sustainability. Okay, next. Okay, next. The next maybe, yeah, okay. So this one, the management objective, this one for fernwood, from poles, for conservation protection, protection, ecotourism, education, research, and development. So we need the government try to manage this area for this kind of objective. Next, okay. This the rotation, okay. So this the kind the management system the rotation from year 2, year 15, year 20, and year 30. This one is the rotation. That's why we can manage sustainably this area. Okay, next. And this is the photograph. Maybe next the photograph of the sustainability. Okay, this a planting area with important seedling. That is the kind of seedling planting system. And then next, see 2 years and then 15 years, maybe next. Okay, next, this one is for thinning, yeah, that has been mentioned here. And then this one is sustainable forest management system that has been established in Malaysia, in Peninsular Malaysia. Okay. This one is the Plok Mangrove Forest Quality Index. Also, we also has been published one MQI, Mangrove Quality Index, so that through this MQI, we also can assess the system or the area of mangrove, whether it's health, good health or not. Yeah, we also utilizing the physical and maybe also pro and environment and upper economical take into consideration in this MQI. Okay, but for this one, maybe next we would like to share in the next session. Okay, on the conclusion, the productivity for failing barking in the barking is has been well produced and then give some contribution to the people, and the cost operation is about like this one, and of course the revenue, yeah, the revenue from the company they can give to the people and to the workers, yeah, and it's about the economy for economical realistic the profit. This one is kind of profitable. And then next, in terms of the next, the last slide, maybe. Okay, the Mata Mangrove Forest harvesting operation is sustainable means for supplying the raw materials of charcoal industry, where annually only 2% from the whole area can be harvested, and after that we plant it, yeah, plant it again for the next cycle. So the practice of sustainable forestry production has contributed not only economically but also social and environmentally, because we can keep the environment and the flora and fauna still can going, yeah, not disturbed by the harvesting. The harvesting only the certain area. So the success in the sustainable mangrove forest management system by Forestry Department of Peninsula Malaysia has in fact contribute to the sustainability of the wetland in Malaysia, which is crucial to the survival and future mangrove forest health. And our research team has also developed the mangrove quality index, which can be shared in the future. Thank you very much from me. Okay, I would like to back again to the moderator. Thank you very much, Fari, Mr. Fari. Okay, maybe any question? Please welcome.
Presentation about management in mangrove. It is very interesting that in Malaysia, the ecosystem of mangrove is very huge. From one of your slides, I went to Mata Mangrove, Kuala Sepetangin, to make a charcoal, full wood, and also forest. It's very interesting, Doctor. Now, we move on to the discussion section. Session, we will have 30 minutes for discussion with Dr. Seja. I'm sure everyone, discussion session. Committee, share screen for question.
Okay, any question, please welcome.
Any question, please?
Okay, we can see maybe from the chat. There's some question from the chat.
I have a question, Doctor. I have a question.
Okay.
The topic is very interesting, Doctor. So, I'm wondering, to increase the mangrove conservation, what kind of direct act of community service that lecturer or student can do? Like pengabdian masyarakat, Doctor. Maybe you have some experience of community service in Malaysia? In mangrove, I think.
Okay. Thank you very much. This is very good question. So, actually, for community service, maybe UPM, so maybe with student, yeah? Staff and student, so regularly we conduct some batik siswa. You know what batik siswa? We planting. We do some activity. For example, the first is the planting. We join some agency, and of course with Forest Department of Peninsula Malaysia. The Forest Department of Peninsula Malaysia provides some seedling. And the student and we are from UPM also actively to replant it, to do some community service, to plant the area. And then, of course, some other time, we also not only planting, also we do some cleaning of the area, yeah, cleaning from the many ways and so on and so forth. Because some tourism come to the area, and sometimes there's throwaway, some waste and so on and so forth, bottle and so on and so forth. And then we do some what we call community service like that. So to make it cleaning and so on and so forth, and beautiful, and to produce some maybe facilities like a toilet in the sometimes so many people go inside and then they need to go to maybe for toilet and so on and so forth. There's no toilet available, and then we do some community service to build some portables toilet, for example, to make the people enjoy inside the forest and so on and so forth. That's so many. We have regularly activity because has been strongly collaborated. As we know that the UPM is producing the forestry is only one faculty of forestry, yeah, in Malaysia, only UPM. So meaning that all of the people in the forest department in Financial Malaysia and Malaysia also, mostly is graduated from UPM. So it's become easy to make some collaboration like community service and so on and so forth. That's maybe from, and the other is maybe for research, yeah. We do some research and so on, like we MQI, we also do some training to the people how to maybe to assess the quality of mangrove. There's also the community service. We conduct some service, yeah, training. Previously, maybe last month, we do some training to LIPI people. And LIPI invite us to how to train some people to conduct some MQI, to utilize the MQI in the area. So later on, maybe we are still apply for ASEAN grant, and then maybe later on we can utilize and maybe we can do some training in Jawa Timur, maybe, yeah, in Madura and so on and so forth. So we make some collaboration, but still finding some fun, yeah, for that one. Okay, so we make collaborate not only in Malaysia, but to East Asia region. So we have one community, so we can do and protect our mangrove, because mangrove is become very important, especially facing with some tsunami and so on and so forth. Actually, the mangrove qualities become very strong structures and can avoid from that strong wave or maybe like tsunami and so on and so forth. That might be what we can share about the community service, and then involving the student and staff and so on and so forth. Thank you.
Oh, interesting, doctor. I think my university, we can collaborate for community service in Matang, actually. Yeah. Or from UPN, we can go to in Surabaya.
Yeah, can.
For community service, right. Doctor, I have a question from Canisius Karo. I think he's a student from UPN Veteran Java. How is the impact of Matang mangrove forest management to local society economy?
Okay, thank you very much. That's a good question. As I mentioned before, from the area, so even the mangrove is very important for environmental, but since our government now that some community live around the mangrove, if we avoid them, try to avoid them, for example, to cut and so on and so forth, maybe there's some encroachment and some support without our participation system, yeah. So we do some collaboration between people and the government. So maybe government gives some land, but maybe very strictly controlled, yeah, cannot do some, for example, fishermen, and then there's some fisher pond, yeah, fisher pond and so on and so forth. And then this one is must license or must register to government first. And then every single company that would like to do, they must follow the rule. For example, there's some rule, yeah. For example, for harvesting, they need to protect the area, and then cannot maybe, for example, cannot cut at the the area that not allow for them to cut, and then they need to planting and so on and so forth, and then they need to protect some from the encroachment. Yeah, like agroforestry, we land them, but they need to protect the area for the whole. So we need that if some people outside come, that they will protect. Yeah, they can help the government also to protect the area, because the area is give some money to have been mentioned. 30 million is quite good. Yeah, 30 million is about 100,000. Yeah, 100,000 million rupiah. To the area, to the community. Meaning that the community can gain some economy. Then also, beside they can gain from fisheries and from woods for chuckles, and from of course, if so many come from ecotourism, they can build some housing, for example, what we call homestay, and provide some restaurant, and this become attract to gain some economic profitable for the community. Yeah, because the summer come many tourism come. Yeah, from university, from outside, also from the common people, they come to see the beauty of the Mata Mangrove Forest. So meaning that many people around the mangrove forest gain some benefit. So this one is true win-win solution. Yeah. They must follow the system, and then they can gain some benefit from the area. That one we call is for the socioeconomic, it's become very, very good relationship. And then this one also contribute to sustainable of mangrove, because they think they this one is the kind of the like what we call perioknasi mereka. Mereka kena jaga bersama. So we keep together the mangrove for the whole win-win solution. From the people, from the government, and for the environment, for the wildlife, and so on, so forth. Okay, thank you.
Okay, doctor. There is a next question from Paramita from Universitas Brawijaya, okay. Doctor. Okay.
What? Yeah, Paramita.
You remember, doctor, right? What local wisdom in being done by the community to participate in mangrove forest restoration, doctor?
Research. Okay. So. As I mentioned before, so the people can join for in terms of restoration. As mentioned before, the mangrove forest, this one area, the area is under forested area, forest department. The area is under state. So many the state that can the people can do some fishing and so on and so forth. And then what the people can contribute to rehabilitation is they also can do some improving in the nursery. Yeah, there is some nursery built by the government, and then can where they can even maybe make some nursery activity, and then government also supply for the nursery for the seedling for the people who would like to plant for the area. Yeah. So near their area. So meaning that surrounding the area, they can plant by themselves. Yeah. Sometimes the planting is need to help today, because if only just natural planting is a bit difficult, but that's why we need to some artificial planting, for example, like doing potting and so on and so forth. And maybe kalau with Professor Cesar Kusmana from IPB, that's a gundulan system. Yeah, gundulan system have to keep the seedling, because so many web come, and then it's easy to release. Yeah, to lose our seed to go to the sea. Meaning that we need to keep the seed in the mangrove area. So that one, what the people can keep is to keep the area. Yeah, from so for example, some seedling has been loose, and then we can replanting and enrichment planting we do. By helping by some people, yeah, because we distribute also the seedling, and then they take some benefit from the mangrove, and then they need to keep some planting and some support, yeah, from the beginning until they the root has been strong, then we can live. That this be some collaboration from the people around the mangrove area. So this collaboration that can contribute from rehabilitation from the people or from the villages, yeah. Okay, thank you, Paramita.
Ini there is a question again from Alif from UTM.
Okay, Ari.
From
University Trunojoyo Madura.
Yeah, from Universitas Trunojoyo Madura.
Maybe someday I will go to Madura. I'm very interested to go to Madura.
Sure. Yeah. It's near from Surabaya, Doctor. Okay, what goals of Matang Mangrove Management? How to reach it? What goals? What goals of Matang Mangrove Management?
Obviously, the goals, as we mentioned, very clear. That this one is sustainability, to make it sustainable. But this one is the for example, that's the production goals, and then also the social goals, and also the environmental goals. So meaning that we do some goals to keep all of everything inside, yeah? Not only give some economic, but also we need to protect some wildlife inside, some flora inside, and so on and so forth. So we need that, this one need to keep, yeah, by the acts and by the rules. So it is, so the goals is to just to keep what the existed mangrove in 1904 is still exist now today. We need that, not changing. So the goal is not changing anything inside the area, yeah, in front of the what we call large area still exists, yeah. For example, 4,000 in 1904 and today is still 40,000, still the same area. The area is not reducing with any others encroachment or any others goals. So we try to keep this area from the whole, yeah, forever, not only 2 days, but we hope that our grandfather, grandson, still can enjoy the area still exists now. It's that area they can enjoy by our grandson, and so on and so forth. Still the same in terms of the area, the situation, the production, and of course the wildlife, and so on, the environmental, and so on and so forth, and then the ecotourism still continuing. And that's why we just maybe keep to the minimal basic needs only, not so sophisticated. So we worried about that some changing in the, like we lose in Jakarta, for example, some area in mangrove forest in Jakarta, beautiful mangrove forest is become the what we call estate, yeah, like kapuk, indah kapuk, and some stuff. That may be under regulation. So we try to keep the area, yeah, still at the mangrove forest as a protection, yeah. The goals, the main goal is to protect the land from the sea. This one. Thank you.
Okay, doctor. Thank for you. The next question, yeah, is from Reni from, yeah, Brawijaya University.
Okay, from Brawijaya. Okay.
Yeah, from Brawijaya University. What is your recommendation for mangrove conservation in Indonesia, especially in East Java, and it in what aspect we need to improve for mangrove conservation?
Okay, thank you, Annie. So first of all, I heard that there's some fishery or maybe petani or fisheries, or maybe some petani, yeah, that farmers that has actively contribute to protect the area in East Java. So many that. This one is maybe the good news for me, and then that's why for the next is just to enhance, yeah, to strengthen the community capability how to protect the area effectively. This one maybe we also maybe believe the apa namanya the kebijakan atau kepandaian kepakaran petani-petani di sekitar pantai, but also maybe they need some contribution from the university, any research or maybe any technique that can used by the people surrounding the mangrove forest, maybe we can sell. But also maybe the how to like maybe learn from the best management mangrove forest in Matang Mangrove, how to make some strong relationship between government and the people. So this one need the participation or maybe the connection or the close relationship between government, university, and the farmers need to build from now. to develop. Not ya, tak boleh asing-asing, not just separately. So make the whole integrated collaboration between the whole, yeah. That one become very strong power for our area, mangrove forest to keep, and then still can gain the economic, in terms of economy, in terms of fishery and so forth, but still can keep the area as the existing, stronger and stronger. So this one is maybe what we would like to continue and maybe to inform and maybe to recommend to East Java. So continue what has been existing now and maybe strengthen them and then make some a good collaboration between government, university and the people surrounding the mangrove forest up there. And I'm sure that the sustainability of mangrove forest will be become very good in East Java. I believe that one. And maybe we are from UPM also maybe open wide some collaboration. If you need UPM to get involved, we can come. For example, to do some research, collaboration, development, and maybe training. That one maybe. And we are ready to go. Thank you very much, Fari.
Is there okay, Doctor? Thank you very much for answering. Is there any question again? Maybe from lecturer from UPN? Maybe from UPN lecturer? Or maybe from UPM also? If you want any question for Dr. Secha?
Okay, from UPM.
From UPM juga ada soalan, sila tanya pada dokter. Yeah,
from UPM, dia is the class ya, the class for them. They need
yes. To from me. Okay. Ini kelas bersama, sila bertanya. Okay, is there any question again? We have 10 minutes again for question, for discussion session. Doctor, we have question again from Dr. Trimu Joko, this is a lecturer from UPN. How to use mangrove as a tourist location in Malaysia?
Okay, thank you. So this one is also a very good question. Yeah, thank you. So for ecotourism, maybe this one as tourism, yeah, the first maybe they need some information and they need some, for example, promotion, yeah. The promotion, even we have many things in the mangrove forest, if you not promote, the people outside not don't know about this one. So like, fortunately, this Mata Mangrove Forest has been established for ecotourism since 3 decades ago. So many things, this one has been well established. Many people now outside, not only in Malaysia. But for example, in East Java, I think there's some, you need to first is to find what is the potential factors that can the people attract, yeah, can attract the people to come. For example, is there any, for example, the wildlife, or maybe, for example, adakah ada jenis-jenis haiwan yang menarik, atau mungkin pemandangan, atau mungkin the fishing seperti di kita di Malaysia, there's a fish pond. So the tourism can come and then live at the fish pond at the center of the rivers, and then they can live and then can be fishing and then can make some cook and by yourself or maybe can cook with so many menus. This one is the facilities, meaning that the facilities need provide because maybe the hostel or maybe the homestay and of course maybe some restaurant and you need. For example, in Mata Mangrove, popular with a soup, apa namanya, soup udang soup, yeah. That one is very popular. And then if some food become popular, this become easy for people come because oh, there's some food, very delicious food in East Java. For example, in Madura Mangrove, there's some kind. That's why we need to provide in terms of indera, ya, mata. Mata kena dimanja. Mata kemudian kalau ada traditional performance yang boleh ditampilkan, kemudian juga dari mulut, musik ataupun dari makanan. So semua kena diberikan kepada tourism. Jadi apakah ada faktor-faktor tersebut? Dari segi pemandangan bagus, dari segi keindahan alamnya bagus, kemudian dari segi facility, kemudian dari ada faktor-faktor one life ataupun haiwan ataupun tumbuhan yang ada, dan kemudian juga kena buat center-center penyelidikan. So sehingga dia selain tetamu yang biasa, mungkin juga penyelidik-penyelidik antarabangsa boleh datang dari internasional. So meaning that semua faktor itu kena ada. Faktor-faktor itu bila ada, akan senang dijual, senang dipromosi. Tentunya dengan satu rule yang menjaga dari involvement dari kerajaan, from government, of course, the masyarakat, dan juga daripada university. Ya, kena guideline sama-sama, bangunkan ekoturism di satu kawasan yang menarik. So dari dan mungkin buat satu jadual yang regular penanaman bersama. Semua penduduk atau manusia senang menanam sebenarnya, dan kalau boleh mereka diinvolvkan dalam penanaman, mereka akan senang karena berkontribusi kepada rehabilitation. Dan penanam itu dijadual mungkin bersama nanti akan menjadi jadwal tahunan. So itu akan menjadi ramai yang datang. Sekali datang 3.000 orang. Sekali datang mereka hanya datang untuk menanam. Lain kali mereka menanam atau ada makanan yang sedap, maka datang untuk makanan. Selain lagi mereka menyediakan booth-boothnya, masyarakat boleh sediakan booth, dan itu menjadi satu pencaharian yang lainnya. Kemudian alatan-alatan untuk fishing dan sebagainya. Kemudian juga di sini seperti di Malaysia, di sini ada elang ya. Elang itu boleh kita bagi makan. Macam feeding untuk elang itu ada menjadi menarik. Waktu kita bagi feeding, elang-elang datang dan itu menjadi menarik juga. So activity-activity kena dibuat. So dengan segala facilities-nya dan sebagainya, sehingga dan jangan mahal-mahal ya. Kemudian semua rutenya dan kemudian jalannya dibaiki, kemudian fasiliti dibaiki, dan ini akan dan kemudian diisi dengan aktiviti-aktiviti yang menarik, dan kemudian promosi yang betul-betul melalui medical. Sekarang melalui media sosial is become very powerful promotion, no problem. Sekarang sekali powerful masuk dalam media sosial, semua orang tahu sedunia. So it's no problem. So that's my suggestion. If you would like to make some area of mangrove for ecotourism. Thank you very much.
Dr. Secha, you must going to Surabaya to see mangrove in Surabaya. I know mie udang is really delicious. Yeah, I miss it. Dr.
Mungkin ada rawon udang mungkin boleh juga di Jabak.
Boleh dicoba dokter. Dokter nah, harus coba rawon di sini.
Daging ya.
Iya dokter. Dokter, I have.
Yeah. Okay, boleh teruskan.
Dokter, we have one question again from Gabriela Aulia Nugroho from Brawijaya University.
Okay.
As mentioned, there are seaward, middleward, and landward.
Landward ya.
Landward, mangrove structure for charcoal production. Will the structure of mangrove plants affect charcoal making process? And which type of mangrove is the best for charcoal?
Okay, thank you. So untuk charcoal sebenarnya landward, kebanyakan kalau seaward dia soneratia. Soneratia itu kain yang different ya. Dia lebih strong dan dia daripada segi pokoknya bukan pokok yang seperti rhizophora. Rhizophora itu yang tadi pokok-pokok besar tadi yang saya gambarkan tadi. Kalau di land seaward dia biasanya dia tidak begitu diambil untuk kayu. Dia tidak, kita akan biarkan seaward itu tidak diganggu. Seaward. Jadi kita ambil adalah di middle to landward. So di middle ada avicennia dan juga ada rhizophora dan sebagainya. So di rhizophora inilah yang kita ambil. Sebenarnya yang paling bagus adalah rhizophora untuk charcoal. Kita mau buat kajian. Jadi kayu paling bagus untuk charcoal adalah daripada rhizophora. Dan rhizophora berada di middle. Jadi tidak mengganggu bagian yang betul-betul menghadap lautnya ya. Kita tidak ganggu, tapi di bagian middle. So in middle and landward. So di landward itu kita boleh. Kalau landward biar kita akan ada nipah dan sebagainya, dia lebih berbeza lagi. Tapi untuk kayu untuk charcoal, untuk arang adalah berasal daripada middleward. So ini yang hasil kajian kami lah. Based on our investigation and research, so the rhizophora is the best one for using for our charcoal in Malaysia. But maybe any others species maybe better than what the rhizophora in East Java. That one is need some research. Yeah. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Secha, for answering the question. Maybe. For student, is there any question again? We have 4 minutes again for discussion session. Is there in there? There are no question again. I think we can move to the next session. Okay, doctor. If you have any question, sorry. Okay. If you have any question, you can write in the comment in the below. I think Dr. Secha will be answer. Okay. Okay, all right, doctor. Thank you very much for the audience. Thank you very much for audience participation, and thank you, Dr. Secha, for the interesting talk. I have a conclusion for your presentation. So mangrove forests have many advantages. One of it is to keep the carbon stock, protection shoreline and coastal area, fisheries, wildlife and ecotourism, also timber products. So mangrove forest in Peninsular Malaysia is huge, and it is important to keep mangrove ecosystem sustainable. Okay, doctor. to meet you here in short time surely not enough, doctor. Yeah, I hope we can arrange for the collaboration for research or exchange student for our student to study more about the mangrove management, right? Yeah. We do hope you always be healthy in Malaysia, and we will welcome you if you visit our university.
Thank you.
Saya tunggu dokter Secha kedatangannya ke UPN.
Siap.
Nanti saya aja jalan-jalan ke mangrove, dokter. Ini mangrove-nya besar, dokter. thank you, dokter Secha.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Assalamualaikum. See you again.
Waalaikumsalam. Okay, in the second session, we will have a Dr. Firman and Dr. Sudiarto. Okay, Dr. Firman, are you there?
Yeah, Mas.
Yeah. Okay.
Jelas, Mas.
Jelas ya, Dr. Firman. Okay. Before we started, I would like to read Dr. Firman's CV. Please commit to share screen about Dr. Firman's CV. Okay, he is a lecturer. Okay, for Dr. Firman, okay. He is a lecturer from Department of Science Marine, Faculty of Agriculture, Universitas Trunojoyo Madura. Now, he is a coordinator program of aquatic resource management. He is focusing in geographic system information or GIS and remote sensing. He graduated from Brawijaya University in 2002. Then, he achieved a master's degree in 2008 from Gajah Mada University and doctoral program in 2019 from Brawijaya University. Without further ado, I would like to invite Dr. Firman Farid Musoni to present carbon estimate in mangrove ecosystem for 25 minutes. Dr. Firman, time is yours.
Okay, Mas. Ini saya. Sudah kelihatan, Mas?
Sudah, Pak Firman.
Oke, terima kasih, Mas. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Terima kasih kepada UPN telah mengundang kami untuk bergabung membicarakan tentang mangrove tadi, dan salam kenal juga kepada Dr. Secha. Jadi beliaunya banyak menjelaskan tentang keanekaragaman baik flora dan fauna di mangrove. Selain itu juga bagaimana potensi pengembangannya, terutama untuk pemanfaatan kayu dari mangrove itu sendiri. Nah, di sini saya akan mencoba mempresentasikan ini riset dari kami 5 tahun terakhir ini, ada hal yang berbeda. Ini tentang stok karbon mangrove. Jadi latar belakangnya bahwa sejak tahun 1970 sampai 16 ini kondisi bumi ini dengan adanya emisi gas rumah kaca ini meningkat terjadi 2 kali lipat. Hal ini disebabkan salah satunya ada beberapa hal, terutama yang sampai 70% ini penyebabnya adalah pembakaran bahan bakar fosil, bensin, solar. Ini menunjukkan bahwa kenaikan penggunaan kendaraan yang meningkat sangat besar. Selain itu juga pembakaran semen dan lainnya. Hal ini menyebabkan peningkatan suhu di bumi ini sampai 1,5 sampai 2 derajat. Nah, Indonesia sendiri di sini kalau dilihat dari penghasil emisi ini 3 terbesar di dunia. Nah, atas dasar itu PBB tahun 14 Juni 92 ini mengadakan konservasi kerangka kerja perubahan iklim Perserikatan Bangsa-Bangsa, di mana salah satu tujuannya adalah menstabilkan konsentrasi gas rumah kaca di atmosfer. Dan kemudian ini diturunkan di negara Indonesia itu dengan adanya Undang-Undang nomor 6 tahun 94 berkenaan dengan pengesahan konferensi PBB ini mengenai perubahan iklim. Di sini Indonesia harus berperan aktif dalam mencegah peningkatan konsentrasi gas rumah kaca di atmosfer. Kalau kita bicara mangrove sendiri, tadi Dr. Serka banyak membicarakan, tapi di sini kalau kita melihat salah satu stok dari seberapa besar sih stok karbon mangrove, ini dari literatur, beberapa literatur ini menyebutkan bahwa karbon mangrove ini dibandingkan dengan penyimpanan stok karbonnya ini ya, dibandingkan dengan hutan-hutan lain, hutan tropis, hutan subtropis, hutan boreal, ini mempunyai penyimpanan stok karbon yang tertinggi. Kalau mangrove sendiri, ini Dr. Serka tadi menjelaskan ada banyak manfaat. Ada, kalau di sini saya mengkelaskan ada beberapa fungsi. Ada fungsi biologis, ada fungsi ekonomis, dan ada fungsi ekologis. Jadi fungsi biologis ini sebagai sumber nutrisi, kemudian sebagai habitat sumber daya ikan dan biota, kemudian tempat pembenihan, pemijahan, tempat pencarian makan ikan, burung, dan lainnya, dan berkembang biak, tempat berkembang biak ikan. Kemudian fungsi ekonomis, salah satunya adalah pemanfaatan kayu, seperti yang dijelaskan Dr. Seka tadi. Kemudian selain itu buah dan bunga, kemudian penghasil ikan, udang, kepiting, rajungan, dan di sini ada potensi ekoturisme. Sedangkan kalau ditinjau dari fungsi ekologis, mangrove ini mempunyai beberapa fungsi yang sangat besar. Yang pertama adalah menjaga kualitas air laut, kemudian menjaga garis pantai dari abrasi, kemudian sebagai penyangga proses intrusi air laut, kemudian sebagai menyerap dan mengurangi pencemaran. Selain itu juga menangkap sedimentasi, dan yang terakhir ini, penyerap emisi dan penyimpanan karbon di dunia. Nah, saya akan fokus ke fungsi ekologis yang terakhir ini. Di sini kalau kita melihat kondisi mangrove, ya, kondisi mangrove di dunia ini, 50% mangrove ini dalam dua dekade terakhir ini mengalami kerusakan. Dan 35% kerusakan itu akibat alih fungsi untuk budidaya. Terutama kalau di Indonesia ataupun Jawa Timur itu budidaya untuk udang. Nah, selain itu untuk pengembangan pesisir. Dan kalau di Indonesia sendiri, mulai dari data 86 sampai 90, ini penurunan mangrove ini sampai 40%. Sehingga di sini salah satu hal yang penting untuk mencoba mencari metode apa sih yang cepat, akurat untuk menghitung estimasi biomasa vegetasi mangrove ini. Ini tujuan dari penelitian kami. Yang pertama adalah mendapatkan data estimasi stok karbon Di sini memang kami coba pisahkan antara kondisi mangrove muara dan mangrove laut. Mangrove muara ini mangrove yang memang ada di daerah muara-muara sungai. Kemudian yang kedua, mendapatkan model perhitungan stok karbon. Nah, ini yang salah satu yang tujuan yang utama. Model dari perhitungan stok karbonnya. Dan di sini adalah dengan memanfaatkan citra satelit. Kemudian dari stok karbon itu coba dari metode itu kita terapkan di Pulau Madura. Kita lihat beberapa tahun perubahannya, mulai tahun 1994, 2002 sampai 2007. Bagaimana perubahannya? Kemudian ini dikonversi ke CO2. Ini konsep dari penelitian kami bahwa di sini di awal adalah melakukan analisis untuk melihat biomasa. Jadi ini dari vegetasi mangrove dilakukan survei. Kemudian survei ini dilakukan sesuai dengan SNI di sini. Ini akan dilihat biomasa di permukaan, kemudian biomasa di bawah permukaan. Di sini akar maksudnya. Jadi biomasa di permukaan ini perhitungan biomasa yang di atas tanah ini maksudnya. Kemudian perhitungan biomasa di bawah. Nah, kemudian ada juga perhitungan untuk bahan organik seperti kayu mati. Nah, kemudian di sini juga perhitungan karbon tanah. Ini tanah ini yang menjadikan berbeda mangrove dengan hutan lain. Karena stok karbon ini banyak tersimpan di sedimen ini. Nah, kemudian ini bagian bawah ini untuk perhitungan stok karbon tanahnya. Jadi ini merupakan tahap satu ini untuk estimasi dari data lapang. Kemudian di sini pengambilan dari citra satelit. Citra satelit yang saya coba manfaatkan di sini dua citra satelit ya. Yang pertama citra Sentinel, kemudian yang kedua citra Landsat 8 atau LDCM. Nah, kemudian dari data lapang dan citra ini dilakukan pemodelan sehingga didapatkan model untuk mengestimasi. Ini sampelnya yang dilakukan. Kami melakukan di Madura, terutama di Kabupaten Pamekasan. Nah, ini untuk perhitungan dari biomasa mangrove tadi yang saya jelaskan di atas tadi, ya, bahwa di sini akan dari biomasa itu ada perhitungan untuk permukaan dan bagian bawah. Kemudian akhirnya di sini akan didapatkan ini biomasa atas permukaan. Biomasa atas permukaan ini kami menggunakan metode alometrik, kemudian biomasa bawah permukaan, maksudnya akar di sini, ini menggunakan, untuk penelitian saya ini, kami menggunakan nisbah akar pucuk. Kemudian di sini untuk perhitungan bahan organik untuk kayu, kemudian ini tanah. Nah, kemudian dari ketiga ini, biomasa vegetasi, ya, perhitungan karbon mati dan tanah, ini akan didapatkan total, karbon total. Ini hasilnya, bahwa hasil dari riset kami menunjukkan, di sini kami mencoba memisahkan antara mangrove muara dan laut, kemudian kami gabung. Dan di sini menunjukkan bahwa antara perbandingan mangrove yang di muara dengan di laut, itu di laut ini cenderung lebih besar. Tapi di muara ini lebih kecil tapi rapat. Kemudian ini untuk perhitungan karbon tanahnya. Dan di sini terlihat bahwa di muara ini mangrove muara lebih banyak daripada di yang laut. Karena memang sedimentasi, terutama dari sedimentasi dari wilayah darat. Kemudian selanjutnya dari kedua data tersebut kita totalkan sehingga kita mendapatkan perhitungan stok karbon total. Ya, ini datanya dan ini untuk yang muara laut ini campuran kedua-duanya. Ya. Di sini kita melihatkan melihat kalau di sini terlihat bahwa yang warna coklat ini adalah yang tanah. Jadi karbon yang paling besar di mangrove itu adalah di tanah, baik itu di muara, di laut ataupun kalau digabungkan keduanya. Itu. Jadi di sini kita bisa melihat prosentasenya bahwa ini kita juga melakukan tanah ini pada beberapa kedalaman. Jadi ini kedalaman untuk yang muara ya 0 sampai 15, 16%. Untuk kedalaman yang 15 sampai 50, 31% dan yang lebih dari 50, 43%. Dan ini sisanya ini vegetasi. Begitu juga yang muara, yang laut, kemudian ini yang campuran. Kemudian ini kalau kita perbandingkan ya, perbandingkan dari stok karbonnya, bahwa untuk karbon, perbandingan antara karbon biomasa dengan karbon yang tanah, ini maksudnya biomasa, ini vegetasinya. Vegetasi baik yang vegetasi di atas permukaan maupun akarnya, dibandingkan dengan tanahnya. Jadi untuk mangrove campuran, ini 1 banding 4,8. Untuk mangrove muara, antara karbon vegetasi dengan tanahnya itu 1 banding 9. Sedangkan laut ini 1 banding 2,8. Kemudian selanjutnya, setelah kita mendapatkan data lapang tersebut, kita melakukan analisis, mencoba mengkombinasikan dengan citra. Ini citra yang kami buat atau kami lakukan ya, di sini ada Sentinel 2 dan Landsat, ada dua jenis citra. Kemudian pada tahapannya, citra ini yang fungsi pertama ini adalah untuk membatasi area mangrove-nya. Area mangrove-nya itu lokasinya mana? Dengan untuk membatasi area mangrove ini, kami menggunakan metode automatic thresholding di sini, OTSU threshold. Kemudian untuk yang identifikasi ke mangrove, ke karbonnya, ini pendekatannya dengan indeks vegetasi. Kita mencoba mencari indeks vegetasi mana yang terbaik. Di sini kami menggunakan 24 indeks vegetasi. Kita cari dari 24 ini mana sih yang terbaik untuk citra Sentinel dan citra Landsat. Kalau kita ingin tahu pembedanya apa sih antara citra Sentinel dan Landsat ini, bahwa sebagai pemahaman awal yang membedakan antara satu citra dengan satu citra yang lain adalah, yang pertama adalah resolusi spasial. Resolusi spasial di sini adalah satu piksel citra itu berapa sih luasnya di daerah fotonya. Nah, kalau lens Sentinel ini satu pikselnya ada yang sampai 10 kali 10 meter. Kemudian kalau Landsat ini rata-rata 30 meter. Nah, itu untuk resolusi spasial. Kemudian ada juga yang kedua, resolusi spektral. Resolusi spektral itu panjang gelombang. Jadi tiap citra itu mempunyai panjang gelombang yang berbeda yang dipergunakan. Nah, di citra Sentinel ini ada 13 panjang gelombang. Sedangkan LDCM atau Landsat 8 ini ada 11. Salah satu membedanya di sini bahwa kalau di Landsat ini tidak memiliki saluran red egg. Nah, kemudian ini kalau Sentinel ini diluncurkan 2015 dan 2017. Ini yang agak berbeda dengan citra lain. Sentinel ini adalah, terutama Sentinel 2, ini adalah citra kembar. Jadi ada dua satelit. Satelitnya ada 2A dan 2B. Kalau 2A ini diluncurkan 2015 dan 2B ini 2017. Nah, kemudian di Sentinel ini sampai sekarang ini generasinya sampai generasi Sentinel 3. Yang diluncurkan Sentinel 3 ini juga kembar, ada diluncurkan 2016 dan 2018. Nah, kemudian kalau ini Citra Landsat yang terakhir ini Landsat 8 karena generasinya sampai seri 8 ya, sampai satelit yang ke-8 atau sering disebut dengan Citra LDCM. Ini diluncurkan 2013. Kemudian ini hasil identifikasi pemetaan dari wilayah mangrovenya, ini untuk yang Sentinel, kemudian ini yang LDCN. Menggunakan metode automatic thresholding atau OTSU threshold. Nah, kemudian kalau indeks vegetasinya, ini ya hasil indeks vegetasinya, bahwa untuk Sentinel ini kita menggunakan 20 bisa 24 indeks vegetasi, tapi untuk yang LDCM hanya 14. Ini kenapa? Karena perbedaan saluran tadi. Nah, ada saluran yang tidak mempunyai LDCM. Beberapa indeks vegetasi ini tidak bisa dilakukan analisis. Selanjutnya, tahapan selanjutnya, setelah didapatkan analisis indeks vegetasi, kemudian didapatkan data pengukuran lapang, ini baru dilakukan pemodelan. Pemodelan ini yang tujuannya kita mendapatkan persamaan ya, persamaan atau algoritma yang nanti kita bisa secara algoritma itu bisa secara cepat kita bisa lakukan untuk menghitung berapa sih estimasi stok karbon di suatu wilayah. Ini metodenya. Yang pertama ini metode untuk digabungkan ya antara total ini. Tadi total maksudnya yang bio vegetasi dengan tanah ini digabungkan. Ternyata untuk yang metode ini nilai R kuadratnya kecil sehingga ini tidak bisa dipergunakan. Kemudian jika kita mencoba pemodelannya dengan dipisah antara vegetasi atau biomasa dengan tanah, nah ini mendapatkan pemodelan yang baik. Hasilnya adalah sebagai berikut. Jadi beberapa model itu kemudian kita coba lakukan simulasi, kita hitung RMSE dan persen errornya. Model mana sih yang paling baik? Nah, jadi animasi sederhananya gini, bahwa ini daun, batang, semak, akar, ini dilakukan perhitungan. Kemudian ini untuk citra satelitnya, dilakukan analisis indeks vegetasi dulu. Baru kedua ini dilakukan berbagai macam regresi, baik linear maupun non-linear, akhirnya didapatkan ini. Jadi persamaan yang terbaik itu ini. Dengan pendekatan indeks vegetasi NNIP dengan persamaan ini. Ini R kuadratnya sebagai berikut, 0,85. Sedangkan untuk citra LDCM, ya, itu yang lebih baik itu menggunakan indeks vegetasinya, ini, FARI. Kemudian ini persamaan yang terbaik. Jadi ini diregresikan dengan data secara geometrik. Kemudian untuk tanahnya, ini tanahnya, jadi tanah dari kedalaman 0,15, 15, 50, dan lebih dari 50. Kemudian selain data itu, juga ada data kerapatan lindak, persen karbon, dan kedalaman tanah. Nah, kemudian ini dari data indeks vegetasi, kita coba simulasikan, gabungkan, untuk Sentinel akhirnya mendapatkan untuk yang 6 variabel ini. Untuk yang 3 variabel dengan RMSE 0,59 dan 2 variabel 0,77. Sedangkan untuk citra Landsat atau LDCM untuk yang 6 variabel dengan inputnya indeks vegetasi, kedalaman, kerapatan lindak, persen karbon, ini RMS-nya 3,14. Kemudian ini yang 3 variabel dan ini yang 2 variabel. Dan dari simulasi ini kita coba ambil kesimpulan model mana sih yang paling baik. Akhirnya ini yang model menjadi novelty kami di sini bahwa model pertama ini diperlukan input tidak hanya kita tidak hanya citra satelit tapi di sini diperlukan input data lapang. Oleh karena itu di sini dinamakan metode hibrid. Bahwa di sini diperlukan data kedalaman sedimen, data kerapatan lindak tanah, dan prosen karbon tanah. Dan persamaannya adalah ini, untuk Sentinel-2. Sentinel-2 ini ada dua algoritma atau dua persamaan, karena nilai RMSE-nya sama. Dan prosen errornya 12,85% errornya. Nah, kemudian untuk citra LDCM atau Landsat 8, itu persamaannya ini. Jadi ini inputnya ada mulai X1 sampai X7 ini. Kemudian nah ini hasil kalau itu dimapkan ya, dipetakan. Nah, kemudian model kedua ini jika inputnya kita mempunyai input indeks vegetasi, kemudian kedalaman sedimen dan kerapatan lindak. Nah, ini. Di sini persamaannya ini bahwa RMS-nya 16,65 memang lebih kecil dari yang pertama, tapi input data yang dibutuhkan tidak sebanyak yang pertama. Kemudian ini untuk LDCM atau untuk yang kalau kita menggunakan citra Landsat. Jadi yang atas ini kalau kita menggunakan citra Sentinel, yang bawah kalau kita menggunakan citra Landsat. Ini 24,8.
Pak Firman, mohon maaf, sudah 2 menit lagi.
Oh, siapa? Kurang sedikit. Nah, ini yang ketiga, ya, model yang ketiga. Jika yang didapatkan inputnya adalah vegetasi, indeks vegetasi dan kedalaman, hanya kedalaman. Kemudian yang keempat ini, kalau kita tidak mempunyai data lapang. Kita hanya punya citra. Nah, kita bisa menggunakan persamaan ini dengan RMS errornya ini 29 sama 93. Ini. Kemudian ini penerapan di kita coba metode itu kita terapkan di Madura ya. Nah, karena data yang lapang yang saya punyai terbatas sehingga kalau kita menggunakan metode satu, wilayahnya hanya yang kita punyai untuk data lapangnya. Jadi ini perubahan untuk tahun 2007 dan seterusnya. Ini perubahannya. Nah, kemudian kalau kita ini yang kalau konversi ke CO2. Nah, ini kalau dilakukan menggunakan metode yang keempat, kita tidak mempunyai data lapang. Ini satu Madura karena LDCM ini ada di satu Madura bisa kita lihat ini tahun 94 perubahannya. Ini 2002, ini 2017, dan ini data perubahannya. Dan kita melihat perubahan stok karbon per tahun. Di Bangkalan ini antara 94 sampai 2002 ada penurunan. Nah, ini kalau kita konversi ke CO2, nah, yang menarik ini ya, bahwa kalau ini konversi ini, dengan sumber dari petunjuk teknik pemantauan evaluasi dan pelaporan PEP ini ya, kita bisa mengkonversi CO2 ini ke konversi ke bensin. Jadi penambahan per tahunnya mulai tahun 94 sampai 92 itu kalau dari CO2 itu 10.295 ton per tahun. Kalau ini dikonversi ke bensin itu 3.959.424 liter per tahun. Sedangkan kalau solar, karena ini konversinya berbeda antara solar dengan premium. Ini kesimpulan dari kami, dan ini publikasi jurnal yang kami terbitkan di jurnal internasional. Terima kasih. Itu yang bisa saya sampaikan. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Thank you.
Thank you for interesting Dr. Firman. Mangrove forests have more carbon than subtropical forests. One of them is Madura Island. It can push carbon dioxide emission amounting to 100,000 tons per year. This high density of mangrove potential contribute to carbon sequestration and carbon stock in Indonesia. I think this is a conclusion for Dr. Firman presentation, okay? Now, we would like to invite Dr. Sudiarto MM from our university, UPN. Dr. Sudiarto, are you still there? Dr. Sudiarto? Hello, Dr. Sudiarto.
Assalamualaikum.
Waalaikumsalam. Oke, dokter sehat dok, Dr. Sudiarto?
Alhamdulillah.
Oke.
Terima kasih, Mas Sehat.
Sama-sama, Dok. Dr. Sudiarto is the head of Department of Agribusiness in Faculty of Agriculture, UPN Veteran East Java. Please share screen CV committee, please share screen CV Dr. Sudiarto. Okay, Dr. Sudiarto is head of Department Agribusiness in Faculty of Agriculture, UPN East Java. He is focusing on management agribusiness. He graduated from UPN in 1987. Then he achieved a master's degree from IBB in 1995. And he finished doctoral degree in 2005 from Brawijaya University. Without further ado, I would like to invite Dr. Sudiarto to share the knowledge about farmer participation in rehabilitation of mangrove ecosystem in coastal of Surabaya City for 25 minutes. Are you ready, Doctor?
Yes.
Yeah, okay. The time is all yours, Doctor. Silakan.
Okay, thank you to Mr. Haidar Fahri. Thank you to so much to our Dean of Agriculture Faculty, Dr. Nora Agustin, for coming into this equation. Before I start my presentation about the project that I did, I would like to say welcome to Prof. Dr. Secha, Ganda Secha from Universitas Putra Malaysia, and also Dr. Firman from UTM. Thank you so much for coming this beautiful occasion via online. I would like to say welcome for all audience. First of all, let me introduce myself. My name is Sudiarto, but everyone just call me name like Pak Sento. I am one of the lecturer from Agriculture Faculty, Universitas Pembangunan Nasional Veteran Jawa Timur. I would like to show you my presentation about my research that I did with the title is Farmer Group Participation in the Rehabilitation of Mangrove Ecosystem in Coastal of Surabaya City. Sebelumnya kami sampaikan bahwa ini hanya penelitian sederhana. Saya berharap penelitian ini menginspirasi khususnya kepada mahasiswa agribisnis atau yang lain bahwa sebenarnya penelitian-penelitian sederhana di mangrove itu bisa dilakukan. Artinya tadi kalau Prof. Secha maupun Pak Firman itu menjelaskan begitu detail, terutama Pak Firman begitu banyak data dan begitu banyak hasil penelitian beliau yang barangkali luar biasa, sangat in-depth, sangat mendalam. Tetapi saya ingin menyampaikan penelitian yang barangkali cukup sederhana dan itu bisa dilakukan oleh para mahasiswa. Khususnya mahasiswa S1. Next slide. Okay. Let's talk about the background. First thing first, Indonesia of lush mangrove. Indonesia have lush mangrove amounting around 3 million hectares, and exploitation area the mangrove continuously and potentially reduce diversity species plant. That is have role and function main in the manner ecological and potential to utilize in manner social socio-economic. Seperti yang disampaikan Pak Firman tadi, ada sekitar 40% dari total mangrove, 40% from total large mangrove in the city of Surabaya has been experiencing damage, jadi mengalami kerusakan. Participation and rural farmer and effort rehabilitation very much needs. Moreover, values corporation, mutual corporation, and various wisdom local in public increasingly eroded. Next. So from the background that we know, we can see the purpose from this research are to knowing and analysis factors, well, what only that influence participation from farmers in effort rehabilitation mangrove and to coast city of Surabaya. To knowing and analysis participation of group farmer in effort rehabilitation, the mangrove are located on the coast city of Surabaya, pesisir pantai Surabaya, pesisir di Surabaya. To knowing and analysis score benefits and score added that obtain group farmer in rehabilitation mangrove in the coast city Surabaya. Next, mangroves have an important role for life and ecosystem party because forest mangrove is vegetation forest that grow on soil alluvial in area big and around estuary river which in influenced by current plug in research water, mangrove to grow on big coral and mainland that sandy thin or and big muddy. Mangrove have a potency that big utilize function for well-being human. Present forest mangrove support by ecological and socio-economic that very urgent. Forest mangrove called utilized in a manner life with the production. For example, wood to ingredient burn, nor fiber tannin, ingredient tannin skin, seperti yang dijelaskan oleh Pak Firman tadi. Or utilization function, for example, as the place spawning fish, nor function protection on system life human, seperti yang tadi dijelaskan oleh Prof. Seca. Next. Method of this research, determination research is done on Kelurahan Wonorejo district Salak influence participation group farmer in effort rehabilitation. Okay, the result. Group farmer mangrove in Surabaya, in city of Surabaya. Group farmer that form on year 24 days on initially have members for 20 containing before public, farmer, fishermen, employees, private, mother house stairs, but within prioritized in public around that are located in Wonorejo East RW 7. Rehabilitation mangrove is a wrong one is that most important in keep ecosystem in the coast peak, especially to mangrove. Saudara sekalian, bahwa wisata mangrove di Wonorejo ini telah menjadi daya tarik tersendiri bagi kota Surabaya, sehingga tidak hanya wisatawan yang hadir, tetapi ternyata para petani sekitar memanfaatkannya dengan baik, bahkan sudah terdapat kelompok tani. Next. The result of research, the factors of influence farmer participation are variable socialization take effect is significant to participation. Variable knowledge show to variable concern environment show to variable role in through organization take effect is significant to participation to. Jadi ternyata semua faktor itu karena begitu kesadaran yang cukup baik di antara para petani yang terbentuk dengan kelompok tani, dan ini rupanya juga dikawal langsung oleh wali kota, untuk karena wali kota adalah ahli lingkungan Bu Risma itu, sehingga bisa mendorong semua anggota kelompok tani itu telah berpartisipasi, dan ini tampak bahwa semua variabel itu menunjukkan pengaruh yang nyata. Next. Ladies and gentlemen, the result of research on farmer participation in planning and implementation activities, we can see from the table that activities planning in information and membership group farmer with percentage amounting to 100%. Jadi semua ya itu telah menunjukkan aktivitasnya. Observation location based on interview that has been done with percentage amounting 82 of which come along involved in therein while to determination location percentage amounting to 75%. Jadi mayoritas itu menunjukkan aktivitas yang berpartisipasi dalam kegiatan perencanaan. Sedangkan pada kegiatan pelaksanaan, activities implementation in involvement member nursery with percentage amounting 100%. Ini menunjukkan bahwa proficiency plan percentage amounting to 25%. Implementation activities planting percentage amounting to 100%. Maintenance plan percentage amounting to 25%. While to do supervision plans percentage that done amounting to 25%. Next. Participation from farmers groups about 88 from the four activities planning that taken based on interview 40 people. Jadi ada 40 petani, dan semua ini sekaligus sebagai seluruh anggota kelompok tani yang diwawancarai. Score benefit life is a score that life felt by public around the coast, forest mangroves, Wonorejo city of Wonorejo city of Surabaya. Score benefit life from score benefits ecotourism, mangrove score benefits body power pond, score benefits fishery catch it. Jadi tampak bahwa di sini jumlah pengunjung itu luar biasa, sudah mencapai sekitar 1.800 orang per tahun dengan harga tiket 30.000 dan nilai totalnya tentu saja mencapai 54 juta. Tetapi tentu saja mereka tidak hanya sebagai wisatawan pengunjung, tetapi juga sebagai pembeli, apakah itu membeli ikan atau membeli produk-produk olahan dari mangrove, dan masih banyak lagi yang bisa diperoleh benefitnya. Next. The mangrove forest area in Wonorejo is not only habitat for various types of birds, but also a source of life for the surrounding community. They cultivate processed products from mangrove plants, which each passing year, the more various types of creativity products are produced. One of them is the bokum syrup. Jadi ada produk sirup bokum namanya. A type of mangrove plant namely bokum, Sonarasia casseolaris or known as bidada merah. Nah, has been used as a syrup since 1998. For the farmer group has invite the local community to make the syrup. Starting from collecting bokum fluid, the final stage name packaging in glass bottles. Now the can see from the value added from this tourism from the table that I mean. Next. Jadi bisa dilihat di tabel ini tentang value added-nya. Okay, so everyone, let's see about from farmer participation in providing education. Participation that done in rehabilitation mangrove with wave from only one to the socialization to public done during this with gift leaflet containing about ban or appeal to cut down free mangroves and give education with make use of fruit mangrove, not the trunk. Leaflet with in give use fun personal and manner volunteer so that public around to the coast city of Surabaya. Jadi para kelompok tani ini, para anggota kelompok tani ini juga membuat leaflet yang dibagikan kepada para wisatawan, kepada para anggotanya, kepada masyarakat sekitarnya, sehingga untuk memberikan pengertian betapa pentingnya keberadaan mangrove di Wonorejo ini. Public around the coast that already form the care to attitude concern environment in manner not aware called the crisis to generation young and so on to keep area the coast with not cut down mangroves and come along fair in therein to do rehabilitation mangrove. Jadi memang butuh semacam partisipasi untuk merehabilitasi mangrove ini, untuk dari semua pihak. Next. Implementation that don't involve group farmer mangrove. Nah, ini sini tambah ketuanya yang waktu itu kami bersama mahasiswa S2. Besides that is the solution that right handling disaster flood, water flood in the is a with a grow ecosystem forest and function to source food for animals that there is ecosystem the sea as crustaceans, squid, fish small and other so. Ini tadi yang sudah dijelaskan baik oleh Pak Seca maupun Pak Firman. Lanjut. Nah, sebagai kesimpulan, yang pertama, faktor sosial, semua faktor itu baik sosialisasi, socialization, knowledge, that inflation participation, group parametric, effect in manner signifikan. Jadi semua itu signifikan. Dan aktivitas rehabilitation, jadi aktivitas dari grup petani ini, grup farmer ini, meskipun ini di tengah kota tapi ada grup kelompok tani, itu cukup tinggi, yaitu berkisar sekitar 85% ke atas. From activities rehabilitation obtains for benefit to member group farmer amounting. Nah, ini cukup besar penghasilannya mencapai 257 juta per tahun kalau di total semuanya. While to ratio score added that generated from making sirup mangrove. Sebagai saran itu group farmer mangrove to regeneration member group farmer and keep doing the socialization and important keep ecosystem mangrove as belt the coast in the city Surabaya. Yeah. Score benefit and score edit looking for innovation that latest to that economic society goal increase. Jadi ternyata berpengaruh positif meningkatkan dari sisi sosial ekonomi masyarakat di sekitar mangrove itu sebagai anggota kelompok tani grup farmers mangrove. Barangkali itu yang bisa kami sampaikan. Okay, so that all that I can say about this research. If anyone really want to ask about this or don't understand about that, am I explaining in some parts? Please let me know, and it's my pleasure if I can answer all the questions, inshallah. Thank you very much, and wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Thank you, Dr. Sudiarto, for amazing presentation. Farmer participation in mangrove rehabilitation is really needed. Mangrove rehabilitation could not be done by individual. It must be done in groups with the sense of social spirit. It is very important to keep ecosystem in the coastal area sustainable, especially in mangrove. All right, I'm sure everyone have a question to Dr. Firman and Dr. Sudiarto for this interesting topic. They would have 30 minutes for discussion with two sections, with each three questions. Okay, I open. In the first section, I will receive three questions. Please, community, share up the question. Is there any question in comment? Okay, first section, I will receive three questions. All right, question for second speakers.
from committee. Okay, how is the effect and relation between mangrove vegetation density and mangrove biomass carbon value? And second question is from Rizky, UBN. I want to ask about how coal mangrove forests become the highest carbon stores compared to top tropical forests, to subtropical forests and boreal forests, which is the large of the amount of the comparison forest is higher. Okay, for second speaker is for Dr. Firman.
Okay, halo?
Halo, ya dengar Bapak.
Ya, terima kasih. Memang di dalam kita mengestimasi untuk karbon, stok karbon untuk mangrove, itu dasarnya kita harus menghitung biomasa dulu. Jadi dari biomasa itu ada biomasa vegetasi, yang di sini biomasa ada biomasa kalau vegetasi mangrove ada yang di atas, di permukaan tanah, kemudian di bawah tanah. Kemudian itu baru dikonversikan ke karbon mangrove. Jadi memang sebenarnya penekanan di hasil riset ini bahwa mangrove ini mempunyai fungsi ekologis yang sangat besar. Gitu. Sampai mangrove ini walaupun luas di beberapa literatur menyebutkan, walaupun luasnya tidak terlalu besar, tapi jika mangrove ini mengalami kerusakan dan karbon ini akan tersubstitusi ke udara, ini akan menyebabkan salah satunya pemanasan global yang cukup signifikan. Oleh karena itu, memang harapannya dengan penambahan-penambahan atau dengan rehabilitasi mangrove ke depan ini menjadi salah satu kita berkomitmen bahwa untuk mencegah salah satunya mencegah pemanasan global ini. Mungkin itu yang bisa saya sampaikan. Memang kemudian dari beberapa, saya tidak, karena gini, mangrove itu sebenarnya tumbuhan yang ada di tropis. Karena dia adanya, ini mangrove ini mempunyai spesifikasi yang sangat tertentu. Dia memang kondisi tanaman yang bisa hidup di dalam kondisi-kondisi yang punya kondisi lingkungan yang ekstrim. Salah satunya adalah misalnya kadar garam yang sangat tinggi, itu dia bisa. Nah, oleh karena itu dari literatur yang memang sepengetahuan yang saya baca bahwa penyebaran mangrove itu adanya di wilayah-wilayah tropis. Nah, memang di daerah subtropis tidak terlalu dominan. Itu yang bisa saya sampaikan, Pak. Terima kasih.
Oke, terima kasih. Okay, is there any question again for the first session? Maybe to Dr. Secha or Dr. Sudiarto also, or Dr. Firman, if you want to get the question. Okay. Maybe Dr. Secha, you have any question to Dr. Sudiarto or Dr. Firman?
Okay. Yes. Thank you, Fari. So maybe for Dr. Firman, maybe I'm very interested that based on your result, yeah, from time to time, so the carbon content is increased, yeah, from time to time. Maybe this phenomenon, can you explain? Well, maybe it is a good information actually, yeah. That's the mangrove in Madura, yeah. The carbon storage from year to year is increased this one is maybe it is because of the condition of the plantation, maybe has been more matured or what, and maybe any other explanation, because maybe cancer. I'm very interested with that one for Dr. Firman. And when for Dr. Sudianto, maybe is this any group of farmers, yeah, that he really concerned with mangrove, and then how the relationship between UPN, maybe based on maybe concern, how to sustain the participation of farmers from the area. Thank you for both of speaker. I'm very interesting. Very thank you. Very interesting.
From, okay. Dr. Firman, good question.
Sudianto. Thank you.
Okay. Good question. I think Dr. Firman or Dr. Sudiarto will be answer this is the question.
Terima kasih, Pak. Saya bisa.
Boleh.
Halo.
Halo. Ya.
Yeah. Mohon maaf. Memang tidak terlalu jelas tadi audionya. Ya. Mungkin kalau saya tangkap, memang perubahan terutama di mangrove di kalau Madura. Mm-hmm. Madura sendiri perubahan terutama pada dua dekade terakhir ini terjadi perubahan lahan, terutama dari lahan mangrove ini banyak berubah menjadi tambak intensif terutama untuk udang. Nah, kondisi ini yang memang semakin terakhir bisa dikatakan semakin mengkhawatirkan bila memang kondisi ini tidak dilakukan manajemen secara baik. Dan memang harapannya kita memang perlu membuat penyadaran, ya, penyadaran. Dan memang dalam 5 tahun terakhir di beberapa lokasi di Madura ini sudah banyak dari masyarakat pesisir yang mulai sadar, sehingga mereka membentuk komunitas-komunitas sadar mangrove, sadar lingkungan. Nah, di beberapa lokasi ini sudah bisa berjalan dengan baik, dan di beberapa titik itu sudah, ini juga salah satunya dimanfaatkan untuk ekowisata. Itu yang bisa saya sampaikan, Dokter. Ya. Dokter Seca. Terima kasih
Pak Firman, ya, Dokter Firman. Okay.
Maybe Dokter Sudiarto, Dokter Seca, can you repeat your question to Dokter Sudiarto? Maybe in Indonesia is okay.
Saya tertarik dengan keterlibatan para petani di daerah apa namanya, nama tempatnya itu saya masuk. Wonosari apa tadi? Nama
tempat. Wonorejo.
Yeah. So jadi saya nampak sudah ada keterlibatan yang aktif daripada masyarakat dan memang dia sudah ada juga penghasilannya diperolehi yang mungkin sama seperti di Matang itu. Saya ingin tahu juga mungkin bagaimana sistem partisipatorinya itu, bagaimana apakah sudah ada sistem yang dibuat oleh government ataupun pemerintah setempat untuk mewadahi keterlibatan para petani ini dengan di sekitar mangrove ini. Itu mungkin yang ingin saya tanyakan kepada Pak Sudiarto. Terima kasih, dipersilakan.
Ya. Oke. Terima kasih Dr. Seca. Kebetulan daerah Wonorejo itu tidak jauh dari kampus kami. Tidak jauh dari universitas kami. Kurang lebih barangkali mungkin sekitar 2 kilometer dari tempat kami. Hanya saja karena bagaimanapun Surabaya adalah kota metropolitan, kota yang begitu padat dengan perumahan dan penduduk, maka Wonorejo ini menjadi daerah yang sudah mulai banyak di apa ditumbuhi perumahan-perumahan menuju ke lokasi itu. Alhamdulillah wali kota kami Ibu Risma Tri Risma Andayani itu beliau sangat sangat perhatian terhadap hutan mangrove yang masih tersisa di Wonorejo itu, sehingga beliau membuat perencanaan sampai implementasinya. Dan beliau mengawal langsung dan kebetulan karena kami juga dekat, sehingga kami banyak diminta, terus kemudian melibatkan beberapa mahasiswa kami yang mau mengambil riset untuk tesisnya. Alhamdulillah ini berhasil karena dulunya tidak ada kelompok tani menjadi ada kelompok tani. Dulu mereka hanya memanfaatkan kehadiran pengunjung wisatawan. Sekarang tidak hanya itu, tetap bahkan mereka juga melakukan penanaman. Dan seringkali ada kunjungan-kunjungan dari sekolah, dari para ibu-ibu Dharma Wanita, yang mereka itu membawa bibit, meskipun bibitnya juga dengan cara membeli, itu kemudian dibantu oleh petani di sekitar situ, itu ikut menanam. Nah, yang sangat menarik menurut kami dalam perkembangan terakhir adalah bahwa dengan mengambil buahnya, yang istilah Surabaya itu namanya bogem. Buah bogem itu dimanfaatkan untuk berbagai macam produk, salah satunya untuk sirup. Konon menurut keyakinan para petani maupun orang-orang yang sudah mengkonsumsi, buah bogem ini banyak khasiatnya. Ya, itu katanya sih untuk menurunkan kolesterol. Ya, itu kami juga belum tahu persis, tetapi ini awal dari keyakinan para petani karena memanfaatkan buah bogem itu. Barangkali itu, Dr. Seca, terima kasih dan pertanyaan yang sangat bagus.
Ya, Pak Sudiarto, saya gembira sekali. Rupanya Pak Ibu Risma sudah terjun juga ya.
Ya.
Yang betul dari pemerintah setempat itu yang memang kami inginkan dari pemerintah dimanapun berada kalau ada mangrove-nya. Sebab kalau tak ada keterlibatan itu mungkin susah juga ya. Tapi kalau demikian saya ikut bergembira ya maksudnya. Sedang dekat lah itu kan dari UPN dan UPN mungkin boleh juga menjadi sebagai apa namanya agent aktif ya untuk memasyarakatkan dan untuk melestarikan mangrove dan juga kerjasama di dalamnya dan untuk ekoturism termasuk tadi ada buah apa tadi yang
bogem
ya yeah. Itu, mungkin memang ini banyak sekali yang perlu diadakan riset-riset yang belum mungkin banyak sekali manfaat yang boleh diambil sebenarnya dari apa-apa saja mungkin yang untuk khasiat untuk manusia kesehatan dan sebagainya itu amat saya terima kasih sekali Pak Sidiarto mungkin itu yang kami ini dan sudah terima kasih saya sudah dapat ininya jawabannya thank you assalamualaikum
ditunggu Dokter Seca kehadirannya ke Surabaya
ya tentu kami sangat senang sekali kalau Dokter Seca bisa ke UPN dan nanti akan kami bawa ke Wonorejo termasuk ke Madura juga dekat tinggal nyebrang
ya. Ke Madura juga dari sana dari sudah baik ke Madura jauh juga
dekat ya karena ada jalan raya yang langsung terus ke jembatan Suramadu jadi nanti bisa ketemu Pak Firman juga di hari itu
semuanya ya ditunggu dokter alat-alat ke Madura sekalian.
Insyaallah Pak Firman.
Okay, thank you very much for question. I will close this first session and I will open second section. Okay, I will receive 3 question for second section. Please committee to share up if you have any question. Oh, okay. From Rizky, right? From Rizky, I want to ask about how could mangrove forest become the highest carbon store
compared to tropical forest, subtropical forest, and boreal forest, which is the large of the amount of comparison forest is higher. Tapi Dr. Firman.
Oke, terima kasih Mas. Sepertinya ini sudah saya jelaskan tadi bahwa memang mangrove itu salah satu tanaman atau vegetasi yang spesifik. Dia hanya bisa hidup di lokasi-lokasi tertentu. Di beberapa literatur saya mendapatkan bahwa mangrove ini hanya dia bisa eksis tumbuh dengan baik itu di wilayah-wilayah tropis ya. Karena memang kondisi cuaca dan kondisi terutama vegetasinya itu cocok dengan mangrove ini. Pertumbuhan mangrove itu yang pertama memang iklim.
Usahakan seminar proposal minggu ini.
Oh,
ya,
saya ini ngajar.
Halo?
Yang Pak.
Halo, apa bisa dengar?
Iya, iya, bisa Pak Firman.
Ya, mohon maaf gangguan jaringan ini. Ya, jadi beberapa literatur saya membaca bahwa memang mangrove ini dia hanya hidup di beberapa terutama di wilayah tropis ya. Karena dia iklim ini salah satunya yang sangat menentukan kemudian pasang surut dan kemudian kadar garam perairan. Ya. Memang terutama dari hasil riset dari Donato. Donato ini yang membuat salah satunya buku panduan untuk vegetasi mangrove untuk transek dari vegetasi mangrove di terutama di wilayah-wilayah Indonesia. Dia melakukan beberapa lokasi sampel di Irian, di beberapa lokasi di Indonesia. Mungkin seperti itu yang bisa saya sampaikan sementara ini.
Oke, thank you Dr. Firman. Next question please. Next question, oke. Okay. Question for Dr. Sudiarto from committee. What are the steps for developing mangrove farmers in Surabaya in order to achieve the expected economic target? Dr. Sudiarto?
Thank you, Mr. Fahri. Pertanyaan yang bagus. Tentu saja bahwa sekarang ini mangrove di Monorejo itu sudah menjadi salah satu ikon di samping kebun binatang Surabaya. Menjadi salah satu ikon bagi kota Surabaya. Nah, kemudian apa yang bisa ditingkatkan? Maka yang bisa ditingkatkan di soal mangrove di Wonorejo ini khususnya adalah bahwa di Wonorejo itu tentu tidak hanya orang datang untuk menikmati lingkungan. Tetapi di situ lebih dari itu menikmati produk-produk. Maka yang bisa didiversifikasikan dari produk-produk itu. Tetapi yang paling menjadi catatan penting bahwa tentu saja yang bagian tanaman yang mana yang bisa dimanfaatkan oleh petani untuk dijadikan produk-produk itu. Sementara ini pada saat ini masih pada produk bogem alias produk buahnya saja. Mungkin ke depan itu tidak hanya itu, tidak hanya dari buahnya. Tetapi memang bogem ini sudah juga dicoba untuk dibuat kue-kue. Ya. Dari semacam ada yang semacam keripik, ada yang semacam dibuat adonan yang kemudian menjadi kue-kue yang bisa dijual. Tetapi ini kan tidak ekspektasi ini tidak hanya soal produk, tetapi bagaimana orang meyakini mengkonsumsi bogem ini tidak sekedar makan makanan yang biasa, tetapi seperti yang saya sampaikan di depan tadi bahwa bogem ini tergolong makanan yang berkhasiat. Nah, ini yang barangkali perlu diteliti karena orang-orang di sekitar Wonorejo itu merasa bahwa mengkonsumsi dari bogem meskipun dibuat minuman atau makanan itu mereka menjadi merasa lebih sehat. Barangkali itu yang bisa saya sampaikan Pak Mr. Fahri.
Okay, thank you Dr. Sudiarto. Is there any question again for the last question? Maybe for a lecturer or from UPM, from UTM or UPN also? If there's any question, I'm closing the visiting scientist. Is there any question? No? I will close this visiting scientist. So we already reached the end for visiting scientist virtual seminar. Thank you so much to all our amazing speaker for addressing interesting topic. And thank you to the audience for your participation. I hope you have learned and enjoyed the presentation and the whole seminar program. Let me also take this opportunity to thank and congratulate the organizer. So now I will hand over this session to the Master of Ceremony. Thank you very much. I hope we arrange a collaboration in research with the UTM, UPM, and also UBN for the next years maybe. Okay, thank you very much. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Terima kasih.
Terima kasih Pak Haida.
Sama-sama Pak Sudiarto.
Terima kasih.
Ya. Pak Firman, Pak Caca semuanya terima kasih.
Izin. Assalamualaikum.
Terima kasih.
Terima kasih.
Dr. Caca.
Terima kasih Pak Sudiarto.
Ya, sampai ketemu. Saya ingin juga ke UPM. Ya,
assalamualaikum.
Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi
wabarakatuh. Terima kasih, Bu. Terima kasih.
Terima kasih.
MC will closing this.
Pak Sudiarto, terima kasih.
Sama-sama, Bu
Deka. Mas Reja.
Ya, terima kasih, Bu Deka.
Oh, I'm sorry. To the next session. Session is closing.
Okay, thank you so much, Mr. Fahri and all the speaker. Thank you so much for all information that we got in this beautiful moment. And now, ladies and gentlemen, that concludes our event today. Before I end this event, I want all the audience to open their camera so that the committee can take a picture to commemorate this occasion. Please open the camera. All participants, we can take a picture. Thank you so much. The documentation process is done. As the master of ceremony, I would like to say thank you so much for our speaker, the committee, and also all the audience. I apologize if I have made any mistake with my attitude or the mispronunciation. Thank you so much. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Jumpa lagi Dokter Seca.
Ya, sampai jumpa lagi.
Sampai jumpa lagi Dokter. Ditunggu main ke Surabayanya.
Amin. Insyaallah.
Maybe pelajar daripada Malaysia boleh datang ke Surabaya.
Boleh.
Daripada UPM.
Ya.
Insyaallah boleh tahun depan.
Ah, boleh lah. Kami tunggu dekat sini ya. Lepas COVID lah. Sebab dekat Malaysia PKB sekarang ni.
Okay. Bagi itu saya mohon pamit. Terima kasih.
Assalamualaikum. Saya mohon izin diri juga. Terima kasih semuanya. Terima kasih.
kasih.
Oh iya, itu tepat saya.
Boleh langsung.
Ya?
Boleh, bisa langsung.
Sudah ada yang keluar.
Ininya tadi lupa. Itu sertifikat tadi enggak dikasihkan.
Oh iya,
enggak apa-apa. Itu makanya itu. Ya walah. Terima kasih Pak Fahri.
Ya.
Tinggal nanti tinjak.
Iya, biar saya.
Lapor nih.
Bapak. Iya, itu Malaysia.
Tinggalkan anu Pak Fahri, nanti tadi Pak Sitan kan sudah menyampaikan boleh ada untuk